For the first talk, I am happy to present Mutant for you. He is active in Hessen. He has many qualifying properties. And he looked into IPv6 for us and fought with it to make our lives easier.
Leichter gemacht und jetzt hören wir von ihm.
So now he will explain to us how we can use IPv6. So I had the idea that I wanted to understand IPv6 better and just to understand what can I do with it? What can I use it for? Can I use it to connect to a remote machine? That's possible, and that's what I want to show you. What I want to show you is how to connect to other computers via internet directly to the IP address. So we are just using what comes with the machine. So usages of IPv6 without working around. No extra software, no TeamViewer, no DynDNS, no static addresses. And no weird apps. What I am using is just everything I have, so a Fritzbox, a router, and a Cascade and normal laptops and stuff like that. The idea I want to present to you, so the method, how can I find the target? Just like mail, you need an address. So what I want to show you is how to get the unknown target address. I'm using a prefix for that and a prefix for location, and that's what I get from my provider. And for the host part, I am translating the 48-bit MAC address into a 64-bit address. So how can we do that? What am I doing? What am I connecting? What do I want to do with this? So I only want to use port 22, that means SSH. SSH you can use for reaching the other machine, looking into it. X-forwarding should work using this. This also works via Wayland, so you can use small GUI tools. Rsync and SCP, so you can copy files, not just some configuration files, you can also copy them, you cannot just look at stuff, you can copy it as well, and that allows you to do a lot of things on the command line already. For many users, this will not be as interesting because they like clicking on buttons, but this is also possible. So if I have the GUI file manager, if I want to use that, for example, Nemo, Nautilus, Tuna, so the usual browsers on Linux, I can totally do that because this includes the option of accessing the server, and that uses also the SSH port 22, just as if the machine was standing right next to you. Is there more? Yeah, of course. LibreOffice has its own built-in client, so you can work in LibreOffice as if you had the files on your own drive. For normal users, that's already incredibly interesting. You can use that for a lot of things. So actually a small group is already using this for home office, which was not the plan. I just wanted to use this for administration, but now we are doing home office with this, and it actually works pretty well and very easily. What we are not doing is SMB, NFS, or 8080. That's things I couldn't handle security-wise, so we're not doing that. So how do I get there? What is the road I have to take? So first of all, I have to get the target address. So I need the prefix for the network part and the host part. Those together make the IPv6 address. So we'll have a look at that. And to get access at all, I have to open port 22 and nothing else. On this part. So that means I have to open up certain addresses, but only those that I have gotten prior prefix delegation. What I do not want to have is static IP addresses. That's the last century thing. With IPv6, you basically don't need that anymore. Only in some rare cases. And that's very nice, because you can avoid mistakes, because you can handle access a bit better. So static IP addresses have a few disadvantages. And IPv6 brings so many addresses, you don't need to make it manually. It's already there. So I have to explain a few terms. So what does this mean after RFC 8415? IP means Internet Protocol version 6. So that means IPv6. I like saying that. What else would it mean? Neighbor? That's a node attached to the same link. So everything that's in our network is a neighbor. That's nice. Very easy. What is a node? A device that implements IP. So I have a device that speaks IP. So with V6, that's better than V4, because back with V4 you had one address per device, but now there are many interfaces on one device, so it can have multiple addresses as well. What's the router or router? It's a node that forwards IP packets, not explicitly addressed to itself, so it's just forwarding things. That is explained here that all addresses are assigned to interfaces, not nodes. So the address is not tagged onto the device, to the box, but to the interface. As mentioned before, a device can now have many interfaces. And now we have enough addresses for this. So we also really need the ULA, unique local address. That's all the addresses within our network. That's like a private address, but it's more than that. It's everything in our network. And GUA, Global Unicast Address, it's not widely used, but it's important. So it's a Global Unicast Address. It's a typical V6 thing. So how are these addresses built? So we have to look at it. It's not that complex. So there's 64 bits of the network number and 64 bits of host number. So we have twice 64 bits. That makes 128 bits. Sounds easy, and it actually is. That's the interesting thing about this. It looks very wild, but actually it's very logically structured. So we have 8 groups of 4 hex digits. So it's very logical and always the same system. And we can cut this address apart. This is not a real address, of course. So we can give it names, and we can say the first part is the public part. Then the fourth group we will call site. That means if you have a very big network, then I would use this part, the light green part for the submapping, and the red part would be the interface part. After RFC 3177, there's another option. So the front would be network number and the back would be the host number.
Da halte ich mich auch so ein bisschen dran. Das ist
still very simple. Das heißt, I always have it
Hälfte, hinten, Hälfte sehr
in two parts.
Aufgebaut. Oder ich sage
vorne, or I can say in the beginning I have the global routing prefix, then subnet ID. Again the same idea. That the fourth group is the subnetting.
Mache, wenn ich das brauche, wenn ich das haben will, oder wenn ich das automatisch.
And the last part is again the interface ID. That's the naming convention after RFC 3587. Then network part in the beginning, then host part in the back.
Das habe ich mir jetzt mal auf in deutscher Sprache habe ich mir das jetzt mal als halbwegs
griffig. That's something that I just chose for the German naming. Then there's the idea prefix. Yeah, the prefix is everything in the beginning, and then interface identifier. So that's what the German Wikipedia would call it. So still, it's always the first half and the second half. It's not very strict about the names, but you have to just make it clear which part you want to talk about. So in V6, and that's the new thing, we have so many addresses per node that you don't really have to care.
Pro Interface und wir können mehrere Interfaces in einem Node haben. Das heißt, wir haben auf jeden Fall
so we have plenty of addresses per node. One per interface, basically. And that's nice because we can just choose whatever we want. So let's check again how the addresses are built. Because it's very important, but it's also very simple.
Dann kann man das auch sehr schnell sehen, was man sieht. So IPv6 addresses are currently defined consists of
64 again, bits of network. Twice, 64 bits.
Host number hatten wir gerade schon. Das heißt 64 Bit vorne, 64
Bit. It makes 128 Bit in total.
Plenty of addresses per interface, address plus global.
So we have an incredible reach. What does that mean?
Wir im Wesentlichen und beziehungsweise die Unterscheidung, die ich
hier. We're differentiating, and I also want to use that differentiation. We use our net and the big net. So the big net in general is the world, that's global. Global addresses always start with a 2, could be a 3, but that's not used yet. So they always start with a 2. So whenever you have a 2 at the beginning, that's a global one. And that can be routed global.
And then there's the ULAs. Die fangen mit FD
an. So, FC ist deprecated. This kind of address starts with FD. That's something like a private address. That's everything in our own network. Everything we put together, glue together, physically or virtually, and our network can work with ULAs.
Rausgeroutet. Also das ist die
that's just like a private address. Then we have locals and local loop. I will not talk about this because it's more not part of the scope, but it's also not needed for us. Then there's stateful and stateless, and I don't want to talk too much about this, but just a short overview.
IANA, Identity
so, Association for IANA is for non-temporary addresses, and
IATA,
and IATA is for temporary addresses. So that's not explaining it, but showing the terms. Sometimes you need that in the setup to see what does it mean, and stateful. Yeah, what does that mean? Stateless is easily explained. You have this nice mechanism with the address auto configuration called FLAG. It's an IPv6 thing. In that moment, when the box is connected to power, the interface already gets its address. So it's not connected to anything, but it already has an address. And that's new. I do not have to assign all of them manually. I do not have to add anything manually. Everything is already there. And what we will use, and there's a lot of mechanisms for that, the router announces a prefix. But in this moment, the router does not even know anything about the device. It just says, yeah, I have a prefix address. Feel free to take it. And it doesn't know if it is taken, gets taken or not at all. So the router does not know anything about the state of the devices.
He doesn't need to know, and he just gives it there out to use. And now these are the IPv6 address prefixes, and so we are separating these based on the scope, whether we're on the outside net or in our own net. And so there's on the one side the ULA prefix, which is valid within our network and is taken from the local autoconfig announcement. So up here I have from the Turosnomia, I have a screenshot where you can just set the prefix for your router and it's being announced and any machine on the network can just take it. So without even knowing what machines we have on our network, we have the opportunity to use this URL prefix, which has the great advantage that whenever I change it on the router, I have actually changed the entire network in a consistent manner. This is great for bigger networks when you have to change them, because IPv6 also gives us the option that it's not just that any devices that have the old IP addresses that are now incompatible. No, all addresses that are still in use can still be used. So up to 254 addresses can be active on one interface. You can see this on servers often, where when the router gives out a new address, then the server may have a lot of IP addresses, some valid, some not. And so yeah, this protocol has actually learned from us and always knows what we want from it. And now we come to the GUA prefix, which comes from the prefix delegation. So we don't set this ourselves. This is coming from our internet provider, which is distributed via the DHCPv6 protocol from RC4779. So the provider sends us a prefix that we get from them. It's specified that we can do that. And then what we have to do for that is we have to tell our router, for example, a Fritzbox in Germany or whatever you're using at home. So you just have to tell it to do that, to enable prefix delegation. Please get this. For example, that there are some screenshots below here for how that might look. ICMPv6 needs to be enabled. For V6, you should always enable this, because otherwise the protocol won't even work properly. But because that sometimes doesn't work with last century internet, this sometimes has to be explicitly enabled. On some devices, this is called ping 6. I don't know where this terminology comes from, but and then you also need maybe a firewall opening. We don't all only need to enable the address, we also need to enable that it's accessible. And on the Fritzbox routers, there's an option for this, which says open firewall for delegated IPv6 prefixes on this device. So basically, the valid prefix is opened up and all the other ones are not, which is exactly what we want. Now, where does this prefix come from? So it comes from your network provider, because it is globally valid. So how do I get this into the network now, and how do I know what it looks like? So I put some screenshots in here so that you can see this easily on your router. The prefix is not necessarily identical to the IP address that the router gets, which is intentional. So I want to have this address, and I tell the router to just use that, and then the router forwards this prefix into my network. So I have a globally valid prefix on my network now. So this can change. From experience, the prefix does change on DSL networks often. So whenever you reconnect your DSL, you will probably get a new prefix. Just expect that. And on fiber access, fiber internet, that happens more rarely, and also on DOCSIS TV cable internet connections, it also changes rarely. But if they work on the back end, on the backbone, then you might get a new prefix, often across months. So that's something to think about. I don't actually know how it is on GSM, on mobile networks, but it's not really accessible yet. So firewall, open firewall only for the delegated IPv6 prefixes, because in some way you need to be able to access this. And then you need the communication. So how do I find the prefix of the device that is the remote? So on some routers, you can enable a push service that you can set up to send yourself emails from about the configuration changes on that router. So, for example, you could also code this yourself with MQTT or something else, that in a way to actually receive information about what your actual prefix is.
So then I have this part from my provider. Great. So I now know the prefix delegation. Now I have to take care about of the host part. For that, I will just go ahead and tell the node, the interface. Please enable EUE64 addresses. That means extended unique identify addresses. And if you click up here on the A, there are links on this presentation, so you don't have to Google it yourself. So this device will use the MAC address to create a 64-bit host path, and that's predetermined, so it's always the same. So it's provided to us. We do not assign this, it's provided to us. And it depends on the MAC address. And please use temporary address. Please turn that on. That's an address that goes out to the world, and it's random. It depends on the time, and it's meant that way. So I want to keep my node anonymous. So the EUE64 address might be valid for a long time. So as long as this interface exists in my node, this is the same. So I do not want to hand that over to others. So please use temporary addresses to stay anonymous. And this will create a random host path, and that's part of the privacy extension. So to the outside, only the temporary address will be visible, but not our stable address to keep our security, keep our privacy. So how do we configure that? Of course, you only have to do that once. So you have to turn on EUE64. Please do not confuse this with stable privacy. We don't need that. It also doesn't do much for us. What we also need is cloned MAC addresses set to permanent. So not many people know about this. In German, it's sometimes translated to duplicated address, permanent.
So
we have two addresses, one that you can read on the packaging.
Auf diese Art und Weise, das noch niemals aus dem Karton rausgekommen ist.
So, there's the MAC address, that's
und die muss man permanent setzen.
Written on the packaging already.
Und die kann also tatsächlich im Laufen
but ohne Reconnect. Whilst running, this MAC, the MAC address, the device is changing, can change.
Nachlesen.
Is using can change.
Ein genauer Link dazu, was das
happened to me. I've seen that.
Dritte Punkt.
And the next thing
is
please set temporary address.
Das ist ganz wichtig,
and we have to set it to 2.
Es gibt auch einen anderen
Stand, you can set it to 1, that means it's enabled.
Aber zwei heißt
and 2 means it's not only enabled, but it's also preferred.
Wenn ich an eine Seite wie zum Beispiel vom Behringer gehe, um einfach
so mal zu prüfen, then
wie komme ich rüber? Welche
Adresse check it on a certain website. To see what addresses am I showing to the outside, I only want to show the temporary addresses, because the other one, as already mentioned, is permanent. It's not as easy to brute force with IPv6, but still possible, so it might still be possible. So always use temporary addresses. So how do I set these settings? How do I do that? So I'm using the NMCLI tool.
Mit dem CLI tool NMCLI.
So here's an example. NMCLI con show active.
Zeigt er einfach an, wie heißt meine
so that shows me the name of my connection.
Und dann sage ich,
and then I say NMCLI connection modify the name. And then I put in the settings as you can see on the screen.
Die Clone muss ich entweder, ob sie Ethernet oder Wi-Fi ist, muss ich die mit einem anderen Befehl setzen, das ist aber egal, das kann man einfach beide.
So you can just test those, if it might be a different one for Wi-Fi, but just test it. Worst case, it produces an error message.
Das ist deutlich einfacher für Menschen, die
there is also a graphical interface.
Haben. Was leider nicht
but what does not work as well, Gnome, for example,
unterschlägt sehr viele Funktionen in seiner
is ignoring
of, GUI, die man direkt aus yeah,
Gnome or Gnome, I'm not sure that, is ignoring a few options. So I'm showing this because it includes all the options. And you can easily set everything. Who wants to see everything? It's in the cookbook. Linked using the German word Kochbuch. I put it in there. It's not reviewed, but it's working for me. So it's working. And so what was it with the host address? When we are building the host part, first we have to have the interface configured. Then
so, dann möchten wir aus der 64
next we need to have the MAC address, that's 48-bit, and we need to turn that into a 64-bit host part. And there's a rule for that.
Dieses EUI 64 Format zu erzeugen, da wird
so it's morphed.
Umgestellt steht im RFC
42. The RFC 4291 Appendix A is where it's written down. And there's a nice tool for that, IPv6 calc, that's in Debian already pre-installed. So we want to have as little work as possible. And for this tool, we just use this 48-bit MAC, turn it into a 64-bit IP address part. So if you just compare the two,
98.de.1.20, 9.a.de.
So here, a bit is split, and that's not trivial.
Ganz trivial. Wer also nicht,
so if you don't like talking binary,
you
better use the tool.
Und in der Mitte,
and in the middle there is FFFE. So you can recognize this from afar, because there's always the FFFE. So from this MAC address, we now
völlig egal, ich habe es tatsächlich schon ausprobiert, das kann man machen aus einfach aus Verpackung.
I already tried it, you can just use the packaging, you can read out the MAC address, put it in.
Von der Command Line, IPv6 calc MAC to EUI 64.
And this part, so we avoid error messages, and then you will get the last part of the address, the host part.
Wir haben also jetzt unseren
Host. So now we have this host part. But please, 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 write down your MAC addresses, but do not give it out.
Ich kann also von jedem Ort der Erde kann ich mit der Liste.
Whenever I have my list, I can just get the host part, can just calculate it myself, no matter where I am, and I have the whole address. So please keep that confidential, the MAC address. So now I have the target address. We already got the prefix, so the green part.
Freigeschaltet, den haben wir vom Provider.
We got that from our provider. We had it sent to us.
22 Gasse haben wir freigegeben.
That's done.
Das hatten wir schon abgeschlossen.
And now we managed to translate the 48-bit MAC address from the of the interface into a 64-bit address.
So wir haben also den vorderen Teil.
The head. We have the tail.
Und das ist genau das, was wir jetzt nur noch.
And that's everything we need to connect.
Damit ist
so that's basically it. I would like to have a small demo, but of course the machines I don't own, I cannot use them, and I can't easily show the MAC addresses and the IP addresses, so it's not going to be a live demo. But of course you can easily just test it out and then write me. So what did we do? We got the network part of the address. We configured the host node, so it speaks the correct protocol. We calculated the host part, the back part. And please use temporary address to make it secure. We opened up the prefix delegation part, so we can get through the firewall. And please only SSH. And then we SSH into the remote machine, and that's done. And then I can do my work. What can I do? I mentioned it briefly. So, first of all, I wanted to just look into a server once in a while and check the config files, and it works great for that. Also, when the addresses are changing, so it theoretically even works using the phone network. And how's this working? Doesn't matter. I'm just using the host part from the address, the prefix delegation I already have. And then I'm just trying and I see, yeah, the machine is there, just connect. And it's very useful because you can do a lot more with this.
People
wanted to do home office suddenly. And yeah, if you want to exchange files, you can do that via the file manager. Just use IPv6. And we have a few people who now use this for home office, even though it was not meant for that. They can use LibreOffice natively and access the server. And it's just as fast as the local drive, sometimes even faster. So I can work directly in LibreOffice. I can copy files with the file manager. I can take everything from the server, take my machine offline, or might even use phone networks in the field. Some modems might not be able to use IPv6, but many laptop modems already can do that. And Vodafone, for example, and I think 1&1, a German provider, they can use IPv6. So in the field, you can use your file manager with IPv6 and copy files to your host at home. I find that fascinating because it's the whole wide world gets accessible using IPv6, and for people who like it, you can work on the terminal. So IPv6 is great without much hassle. I showed to you what I wanted to show.
Sollte man eigentlich vertiefen, der Vortrag dauert eigentlich anderthalb Stunden, wenn man hier daraufhin ausbaut, was er eigentlich sein sollte, nämlich auch mal ein bisschen
CIV6
vorzustellen. Ich hoffe, es ist trotzdem rübergekommen.
I got my points across. You can read up on this. There's a lot of things. So the difficult thing is that it's hard to get information. So there are many definitions. A good Documentation is usually very old. What I liked from the content is the podcast from Annalena Becker with Clemens Schrimpel. A lot of content. I do guess it's in German though. The cookbook is online. And here two addresses, testschrimpel.de and IPv6, there you can see your external address that is sent out. So it should always be the randomly generated one, because otherwise other people might be able to access your machines. If you have further questions, mutant@chaospod.de.
Und dann sage ich einfach,
just let me say thank you very much.
Wer noch Fragen hat,
if there are further questions, I'll do my best.
Ja, Mutant, danke für deinen
Vortrag. Yeah, thank you for your talk. I really liked it.
Gemacht, dieses Projekt nochmal anzugehen, weil durch meinen
Router. And my router only supports IPv6.
Kabelmodem.
Yeah, fiber is great.
Kabel ist gut. Sage ich erstmal nichts. Ich bin froh, dass ich jetzt.
Alright, I'll not say anything then. So, I've seen that some questions have removed from the pad, which shines a good light on your talk. We don't have a lot of time anyway. So, let's start with the first one. So, if one activates the privacy extensions, for example, RFC 4941, then the IP addresses change, don't they? How can we calculate them then? No, they don't. That's the nice thing. They add more addresses, so I receive more addresses, and the temporary address is used as one more temporary address, but the original one is still there, but it's just not routed outside. So that's the nice thing about V6. So it V6. So it has a lot of addresses, and I can just use those that are good for my use case. If it's a ULA or a linked local address, so it doesn't change by getting this temporary address. It's just a further address that I can use, and the original one is still set. So that's the funny thing about V6. I just choose the address that I want to use. And that's the thing that maybe some people don't get, that like the last century IP with the static addresses. So next question, a comprehension question. So the explicit forwarding and enabling of SSH access. So the SSH access is only on port 22, right? So yeah, I only wanted to enable port 22. The router has to enable that. So this product from AVM does support this very well. I can have a look at this right here. So yeah, I can go into my configuration and just set it to enable access to the specific prefix. For the host part, that is not relevant here. It's only the network part, and so I can enable the prefix delegation to allow this to go to through the router. And then how you actually have to set this on the router, that depends on the manufacturer. But with AVM, it's very easy, because I can really just say, give me exactly this path, no matter what it is, just enable this. And so even if the router reboots or whatever and the address changes, it always enables the traffic to this prefix through the firewall. And yeah, that has to happen on the router, which is the outside router, the router that talks to the global prefix given by the provider. And yeah. And then on the router, I have to enable this, which again, I can't say for every router manufacturer. So last question, I hope it's a compact answer. So how can I combine this with local DNS, with for example, a host file? Oh yeah, that's a good thing to mention, yeah. So I only set this prefix delegation and MAC address, that is the host part, in the etc. hosts file, and set my alias behind that, and then I use that alias in the file browser, or in LibreOffice, or something like that. I don't even need a DHCP server, maybe if I want one, I could like pull up a big system there, but we wanted to have it very simple. So just put an alias into your etc. hosts file, and because yeah, maybe you don't really want to write out the whole address, sometimes with brackets, sometimes without. In SSH it's without, on TCP and HTTP it is with, and sometimes you don't know. Yeah, that's actually a good thing to mention. Please write an alias into your etc. hosts file, and whenever the prefix changes, then the network part needs to be changed in your etc. hosts file, of course. But yeah, I have automated this with a script, and even an end user that has no idea what all this is can probably do that very easily, and that is actually how we do it. Because the end users are not necessarily computer freaks, they don't really know how any of that works, and they probably don't want to open a terminal. But they can also change the prefix that is written in the hosts file. All right, so we are explicitly perfectly out of time. Thank you for your talk and the quick Q&A. And I hope you have a nice day. Thanks a lot to you all too.